In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
This afternoon, we're not going to try to look at 10 questions like we started to start doing this morning. We're just going to try to look at one. Didn't get anywhere near the 10, so we'll try to see if we can get to one. And to get started on this question, if you have your Bible, I'd like to invite you to open it to the book of Daniel, the 8th chapter. Now, by the way, if you're talking about the foundations and pillars of the Christian faith or the foundation and pillar of Adventism, this is part of the foundation, or you could call it the central pillar of Adventism. If you have your Bible open to Daniel 8:14, we could read verses 9 to 13 to get some context. We'll just look at verse 14. Get started quickly. It says, "He said to me, 'For 2,300 days,'" or the original text says, "unto 2,300 evenings and mornings." That's a biblical expression for a day. "Then the sanctuary shall be cleansed." The Hebrew word there is nitzdek, which theologians spend lots of time discussing because it's not, that's the only place in the Bible where that particular usage of, it's a common word, but that verbal usage is used. It means cleansed or made right or set right. And we talked about this, we studied this in our camp meeting, how that in the 1840s there was this tremendous religious awakening. It actually started before the 1840s. It started in the last part of the 18th century and extended into the 1840s. And the most prominent preacher of this passage of Scripture in America was who? William Miller. And we talked about that in our camp meeting. And the result of that then was the development, not just of the Second Advent movement later, but in 1844 when this prophecy was fulfilled, because that's when the 2300 days reached to, is to October 22, 1844. And when that happened, what happened in America? What do we call it? We call it the Great Disappointment. The Great Disappointment. And why were they disappointed? What was their misunderstanding that caused them to have the Great Disappointment? You remember? That's right. They didn't understand what the sanctuary was. They thought that it was the earth. That, by the way, that was a common belief in those days. And afterward, we studied how that a few people, such as Hiram Edson and Crozier and several others, Joseph Bates, they were studying their Bibles and praying, and the Lord opened up. In fact, the Lord opened up first the very next day to Hiram Edson what the mistake had been, and so they learned the biblical teaching of the sanctuary in heaven. And you can study about the sanctuary in heaven in the New Testament, because the Apostle Paul went to great pains to help the Hebrew Christians understand that the sanctuary in heaven had actually replaced the sanctuary on earth. And the Lord had given them a very strong signal of that when Jesus was crucified. What was the strong signal that the Lord gave to the Jewish people when Jesus was crucified that the sanctuary on earth was not where it was at anymore? What was the signal? That's right. The veil of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom by an unseen hand. And as I've mentioned before, that that veil was not like a curtain that you have in your living room. That veil, the closest thing that we have, you can say it was more like a Persian rug. It was a very thick tapestry that you could not see through. And nobody like me. Now, maybe, I don't know if somebody was like Samson, maybe they could tear it, but even Samson couldn't tear it from the top to the bottom. And so it was torn from the top to the bottom. It was torn from the top to the bottom so everybody would know that no human being did this. No human being did this. It was torn from the top to the bottom. Human being couldn't reach that high. And so the Lord had given them this signal, and the Apostle Paul made this very, very clear in the book of Hebrews. You can look if you want to study it, especially at chapters 8 and 9 and 10, where he discusses this in detail. Not only that, but in the book of Revelation, the Apostle John says that he saw it, not only saw it, but he talks about different furniture. He talks about the candlesticks and about the golden altar and about the Ark of the Testament. He talks about all those things in the book of Revelation in the heavenly sanctuary. So Adventists then began to teach this, and if you know, this is the foundation of the Second Advent movement, if you know of any other religious group that teaches about this, well, I would like you to inform me, because I personally am not aware of any other church or any other religion, and I'm not trying to disparage any religion, but I don't know of any that teaches this or understands the biblical teaching about this. However, this text here in Daniel 8:14, 2,300 days, then the sanctuary will be cleansed, then it'll be set right. Is it possible that it could have a deeper meaning than even the Adventists understood when they first began to teach this? Is that possible? Well, we find that when we study almost any doctrine. When it first began to be taught, as it developed, did there eventually come a fuller understanding of the doctrine than when it was first taught? And so, it happened actually in the 1950s. And there was a young man, you see, in the doctrine of the sanctuary and the cleansing of the sanctuary, there is coming a time, and we studied about this in our Sabbath school this morning, there is coming a time when that will be finished. You believe that? If the sanctuary is going to be cleansed, well, there will be a time when that's done. No one have to do it anymore. It'll be done. Well, when will that be? See, that's where many people in other Christian faiths don't understand. They think that that'll maybe happen sometime when Jesus comes or after Jesus comes. But the Bible's very clear, and we studied this in Sabbath school this morning, that it's going to happen before Jesus comes. And I want to read you just one text about this. Look in the book of Revelation, the 15th chapter. Revelation, the 15th chapter. Where, when we talk about the cleansing of the sanctuary or the judgment, because the judgment and the cleansing of the sanctuary is a very similar event, although I'm not saying they're exactly the same. When we talk about it, where in the sanctuary does that take place? In the most holy place, or in the temple. So it's in the temple where this takes place. And I want you to notice something in the book of Revelation, the 15th chapter. Now, the book of Revelation, the 15th chapter, is about when the seven last plagues are poured out. Do you see that? Revelation 15 and verse 1. Revelation 15 is about when the seven last plagues are poured out. Now, I want you to notice something here in Revelation, the 15th chapter, about when the seven last plagues are poured out. Look down to verse 8. That's the last verse in the chapter. It says the temple was, that the temple, now the temple and the sanctuary are the same thing. Sometimes it's translated temple, sometimes it's translated holy place, sometimes it's translated holy places, sometimes it's translated sanctuary. It's all talking about the same thing. So when you read here about the temple, or if you read in the book of Hebrews, the sanctuary in heaven, the temple in heaven is the same place. Now look what it says here in verse 8. The temple was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from His power, and no one was able to enter the temple till the seven plagues of the seven angels were completed. So let me ask you a question. If all mediation takes place in the temple and nobody can go in there now, what does that say about your mediator? You don't have one. So you don't. When this happens, you're not going to have a mediator because nobody. The mediation takes place in the temple, and nobody can go in there. Well, like I mentioned this morning, I have been studying this subject for a long time, and I'm still trying to understand it. I want to understand more about it. But in the 1950s. There was a young theology student at Avondale College who was trying to figure this thing out. How can you live in the presence of a holy God without a mediator? How can that ever happen? And he started trying to study this. And his name was Robert Brinsmead, and he came up with some ideas about how this could happen. And people became so interested in learning about what his ideas that he was developing about this, that he was invited to preach not just in Australia, but even in the United States. I can still remember it was in, about 1960. About 1960, my parents went on Sabbath afternoon. I wish I'd have gone. I didn't go. I stayed home Sabbath afternoon. My parents went to Boulder, Colorado, to listen to Robert Brinsmead give a lecture to talk about what he had discovered and what he was believing and teaching. And when my parents came back from this meeting, they had a couple of books. I looked over the books. Now, sorry to tell you, instead of just investigating what he had been studying out, somehow a huge theological fight developed. And by the time I started studying theology at Walla Walla College, this was a full-blown fight of the General Conference and our conferences against Robert Brinsmead. And when I became a minister, I received from the General Conference, a Seventh-day Adventist minister, I received from the General Conference I still have it, a stack of literature probably an inch thick made by what they called the Defense Literature Committee, and their literature was against Robert Brinsmead, and there were debates all over the world about Robert Brinsmead, and I'm not here to either promote or defend or excuse anything about Robert Brinsmead, but I ask you the question, is there possibly a deeper meaning to understanding Daniel 8:14 than just to understand about the sanctuary in heaven? Well, there for sure is. And the reason I know that there for sure is because actually some of Robert Brinsmead's ideas are backed up by the spirit of prophecy. And what Robert Brinsmead was teaching was that the cleansing of the sanctuary doesn't simply involve something that goes on in heaven. The cleansing of the sanctuary involves something that happens in you. And that's true. I had a theology teacher that used to tell us, he said, just remember that in every heresy, there's always little truth. And I found that to almost always be the case in every, quote, heresy. You check it out. There's some truth, and then there's some other things. And so I'm not endorsing what Brother Brinsmead was trying to figure out, but he was trying to figure out the answer to a theological problem that I personally have not figured out, and I've been working on it for over 40 years, and I know ministers that have been working on it longer than I have. And I've never seen anybody that can explain some of the things that Robert Mincemeat was trying to explain. I tried to figure it out in the 1970s, and finally I decided the Lord hasn't given me enough information in the spirit of prophecy that I can definitively give an answer, so I have to leave that with Him, not try to explain everything. So we're not going to try to explain what the Lord hasn't explained, but anything that God has explained, we should study it and try to understand it. Don't you believe that? So when we talk about the cleansing of the sanctuary, we need to always understand that we're not simply talking about something that happens in heaven. What happens in heaven is to happen in me. And I have tried to explain it in various ways at different times. To get started, let's just read just from one page in the book Desire of Ages. This is about when Jesus cleansed the earthly sanctuary when He was here. And this is Desire of Ages, page 161. Let me read to you what Ellen White says about this cleansing of the sanctuary. This is the cleansing of the earthly sanctuary now. She says, in the cleansing of the temple, Jesus was announcing His mission as the Messiah and entering upon His work. That temple, erected for the abode of the divine presence, was designed to be an object lesson for Israel and for the world. Okay, if it was an object lesson, then the next question is, what am I supposed to learn from this object lesson? Well, she's going to explain what we're supposed to learn. She says in the next sentence, from eternal ages, it was God's purpose that every created being, from the bright and holy seraph — a seraph is a class of angels — from the bright and holy seraph to man, should be a temple for the indwelling of the Creator. So, the temple at Jerusalem was a symbol of what? A soul temple. A soul temple. By the way, Ellen White, I found, as I checked it out, she uses that terminology over and over again about the soul temple. There's a sanctuary in heaven. It's a temple. A temple, a sanctuary, is a place. Any temple is a place where a deity dwells. But the deity does not just want to dwell in the temple in heaven. The deity wants to dwell where? In the creature. That's what we just read here. It says, because of sin, humanity ceased to be a temple for God. Darkened and defiled by sin, the heart of man no longer revealed the glory of the divine, but by the incarnation of the Son of God, the purpose of heaven is fulfilled. God dwells in humanity, and through saving grace, the heart of man becomes again His temple. God designed that the temple at Jerusalem should be a continual witness to the high destiny open to every soul. So this building was to be a symbol of what? What could happen to you? What could happen to me? Because this building was a place where deity dwelt. And it was a symbol of what deity wanted to do for every human being. The deity wanted to dwell in every human being. But because of sin, it became impossible. And Jesus came here so that it would again become possible. And then she says, but the Jews had not understood the significance of the building they regarded with so much pride. They did not yield themselves as holy temples for the divine spirit. The courts of the temple at Jerusalem, filled with the tumult of unholy traffic, represented all too truly the temple of the heart. Defiled, that's the human heart, defiled by the presence of sensual passion and unholy thoughts. Let's think that through for a moment. We want to make our understanding practical. Can the Holy Spirit dwell in my mind, in my heart, if my heart is filled with sensual passions and unholy thoughts? No. Unless my soul temple is cleansed from that, I'm stuck. I cannot be a temple for the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. She says, in cleansing the temple from the world's buyers and sellers, Jesus announced his mission to cleanse the heart from the defilement of sin, from the earthly desires, the selfish lusts, the evil habits that corrupt the soul. And then she goes on, she quotes Malachi 3:1-3. She quotes 1 Corinthians 3:16 and 17, where it says that we're to be a temple for the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. But then she says, this is the bottom of the page, no man can of himself cast out the evil throng that have taken possession of the heart. Now, I've been trying to understand those things for over 40 years. As a result of the fall of Adam and Eve, when Adam had a son, Seth, it says he had a son in his image, and he had, at that time, he was a fallen human being. He had fallen human nature. The devil claims and still claims every member of the human race as his. And if you live in sin, the devil says to the whole universe, and nobody can contradict him, that person is mine. You'll have to answer it for yourself. Is it true that there is an evil throng that has taken possession of people down here, of people even in the church? And she says here, we can't cast it out. We cannot cast out the evil throng. That's quite a sentence, by the way. You know what a throng is, don't you? A throng is more than one, and it's more than two or three. You remember the man that was possessed of the devils, and Jesus said, what's your name? And the devil said, we're legion. We're many. How many evil spirits were in control of that man? Well, a legion was 5,000 or 6,000. This is a very interesting sentence here at the bottom of page 161 of Desire of Ages. No man can cast out the throng. What throng is that? It's the evil spirits. By the way, I don't want to become a specialist in studying about what evil spirits do, but I know a little bit about evil spirits, and there are different spirits that specialize in different sins. And she says here that there is an evil throng that's in the heart of man, and we cannot cast them out. Then she says, after she says, no man can of himself cast out the evil throng that have taken possession of the heart, it says, only Christ can cleanse the soul temple. See, Daniel 8:14 is not just talking about something that happens in heaven. It's talking about something that is to happen down here in a human being, in the heart. And it's talking about something that you and I can't do. I just read it to you. We can't do it. In fact, she says, only Christ can do it. There's nobody else that can do it. And then she says, but he will not force an entrance. He comes not into the heart as to the temple of old, but he says, I stand at the door and knock. She's quoting from Revelation 3:20. So I said, just going to ask one question tonight, not six or eight. One question. It's a question that is profitable for each one of us to ask of ourselves. I'm not asking you, I have to ask me, for me. And you can ask for you, but I can ask for me. And the question is my soul temple cleansed from its defilement? Is my soul temple cleansed from its defilement? Here's a few statements that Ellen White wrote about this. Here's one. This is from Review and Herald, October 28, 1884. She said, God requires the earthen vessel, that's you and me, the earthen vessel, containing this treasure, the treasure is the gospel, God requires the earthen vessel containing this treasure to be pure, the soul temple to be cleansed of its defilement. It's necessary for my soul temple. It's necessary for your soul temple, if you want to go to heaven, to be cleansed of every defilement. When I started looking up, I found out that Ellen White wrote about this over and over again. Here's an interesting statement from the Review and Herald, December 17, 1889. She wrote, the angels were amazed at the great love of Christ that led him to suffer and die on Calvary to rescue man from the power of Satan. The work of redemption is a marvel to the angels of heaven. Why then are we, for whom so great a salvation has been provided, so indifferent, so cold, and unloving? It's an awful question. It's a question we need to think through and pray about. Why is it? The angels are astonished that Jesus would do this. She says that. They were amazed. But we are indifferent and cold and unloving. And then she speaks especially to children. This is what she says. Children, you can do errands for Jesus which will be wholly acceptable to him. You can bring your little gifts and offerings to Christ. The wise men who were guided by the star to the place where the young child was brought offerings of gold and frankincense and myrrh. When they found the promised one, they worshiped him. Children, you may ask, what gifts can we bring to Jesus? You can give him your hearts. What offering is so sacred as the soul temple cleansed from its defilement of sin? Jesus stands knocking at the door of your hearts. Will you let him in? Do you want to be cleansed? My dear friend, I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to me just as much as you. It's for every one of us. We must be cleansed. Our soul temple must be cleansed of every defilement if we're going to go to heaven. And it has always been true that the soul temple must be cleansed of every defilement to go to heaven. However, we are living in a special time of Earth's history. In past ages, you had, as long as you lived, for this to take place. And some people waited until the last hours of life, and that's exactly what happened to the thief on the cross. And it is still true, and I have had this experience of myself. I have seen people that I believe were saved in the last hours of their life, and I expect to be with those people in heaven. But we're living in a time that is different than any other time. We're living in a time when there are going to be people living on the earth, and they won't have until they die to get ready to go to heaven for their soul temple to be cleansed, because the temple service is going to be closed up while some people are still alive here down on the earth. And so when that happens, if my soul temple isn't cleansed at that point, then I'll be lost. And so that is the reason the Second Advent movement exists, to tell people and to invite them, say, you must get ready. Your soul temple must be cleansed so that you'll be ready for Jesus to come. In the Review and Herald, November 28, 1899, Ellen White quoted in an article from 2 Corinthians 6. If you have your Bible, I invite you to open to 2 Corinthians 6. And here's what it says. It's talking about this subject. If you look at 2 Corinthians 7:1, it's talking about cleansing ourselves from all impurity of the flesh and spirit. But notice what it says, starting in verse 14 of 2 Corinthians 6. It says, do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean. Now, if you want to, we're not going to do this now, but if you want to do it on your own, you can study this in type back in the Torah. That's the first five books of the Bible. And you can study it in Exodus and Leviticus and Deuteronomy. If you touch something that was unclean, what happened to you? You became unclean too. The reason for those ritual experiences, part of it was, of course, was to protect them from communicable diseases. But it was also to teach them something spiritual. When you bring yourself into contact with something that is unclean. By the way, all sin is unclean. When you bring yourself in contact with that, then you become unclean too. Does that make sense? We each need to think this through in regard to our own lifestyle, how we live, what we do. We live in a world where there's sin all around us. We cannot escape it. We cannot fly away. But the scripture says, don't touch it. Don't touch it. In other words, keep yourself separate from the sin. I think I better make this really clear. That has to mean there are some business establishments and some buildings in the city of Wichita where you should not be going in there if you want to be a Christian, because you're going to get unclean. You're going to bring yourself into contact with something that's going to defile you. Does that make sense? And if that's the case, then of course that means that there are some occupations that you will not be able to engage in as a Christian. Does that make sense? Somebody says, well, Pastor John, how am I going to make a living? The Lord, if you pray and dedicate your life to the Lord will open up a way for you to make a living without having to be in contact with sin that will defile you. It says, do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Now, Ellen White quotes that text, and then here's what she comments about it. She says, "Never was there a time when this warning was more appropriate than at the present time. Far too large a number of professed Christians are Christians only in name. They have no root in themselves. Their hearts are filled with pride, impurity, unholy ambition, self-importance, and love of supremacy. They may have an intelligent knowledge of the theory of the truth and prove their doctrines to be sound and scriptural, but they hold the truth in unrighteousness. By their course of action, they deny the Savior. Their hearts are not sanctified through the truth. They are unholy in heart and unchristlike in deportment. Unless the spirit and principles that characterize the life of Christ are planted in the heart, they cannot control the life. The law of God must be written in the heart. The truth of God must illuminate the soul. Holiness, mercy, truth, love must be brought into the life. Unless the soul temple is cleansed from its defilement, unless there is purity of heart, unless earnest efforts are made to meet the standard of God's word, they will never be fitted to be the companions of the pure and holy. They will never wear the white linen, which is the righteousness of the saints." Well, do you want to be fitted? See, to go to heaven, we must not only have a right, we must not only have a title to go there, we must be fitted to go there. The Lord wants you to be saved. And the Lord can save you. The Lord can cleanse you from all defilement if you'll cooperate. If I may use common language, let me just say, the Lord wants to make a deal with you. The Lord wants to make a deal with you. And if you dedicate and consecrate yourself to me and don't hold anything back, I'll cleanse you. But you have to cooperate because I won't force it. And the great tragedy today in Adventism is, I hate to have to say this, we won't let the Lord do it. We won't yield everything. We won't say, "Lord, whatever you have to do in my life, I surrender everything. I commit everything. Anything that's wrong, Lord, in the way that I'm thinking, in the way that I'm feeling, in the way that I'm acting, in the way that I'm talking, whatever it is in my life that's not right, Lord, point it out and give me the grace to change. I want to be lined up with your program. I want to be cleansed. I want to be changed." Are you serious about being in the kingdom of heaven? You can be. You can be. God is going to save every single person that will allow himself or herself to be saved, which involves being cleansed. I want to read this in closing. This is a wonderful, wonderful promise. I think you'll enjoy this. It says, "The Father takes no pleasure in the death of the sinner, but he wants him to repent of his sins and turn to righteousness and be saved. When the sinner desires the approval of the Lord more than anything else and is willing to make any and every sacrifice for the love of Jesus, he may settle it in his mind as a fact that if he perseveres, he will stand finally in the city of God upon the gold-paved streets." Are you willing to make a complete commitment and say, "Lord, I'm serious. I'm serious. I want you to give me whatever rebuke, whatever reproof, any correction, whatever I need. I'm serious. I want to be cleansed. She says, if you're willing to make any and every sacrifice, you can settle it. If you've made that decision, you're willing to make any and every sacrifice, it's a fact. You are going someday to stand on the golden streets. Are you serious? I'm serious. Let's pray that the Lord will help us to make a complete commitment to say, Lord, I'm willing to make any and every sacrifice. I want to be cleansed. If you make that commitment, the Lord will do it. He doesn't fail. But the reason it doesn't happen is because we don't make the commitment. So let's make the commitment. Let's pray about it now before we go. Father in heaven, we thank you that when we were ruined, that you devised a way that we could be cleansed, not only forgiven of our sins, but cleansed from all unrighteousness. And Lord, we know that it is your design that each one of us, that our soul temple be cleansed from all defilement. We know that's your will because you've told us so. We've read it from the inspiration of the Spirit of Prophecy and from the Bible. Lord, help us each one right now to say, Lord, I am choosing to make any and every sacrifice so that your will may be worked out in my life, so that I might be cleansed. And I pray, Lord, that you will cleanse me from all unrighteousness so that when Jesus comes, I may be among that white-robed throng that will stand on the gold-paved streets. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.